Through you, I can do anything. I can do all things. 'Cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible. Through you, blind eyes are open. Strongholds are broken.
Almighty. Impossible for him. Amen.
Amen.
And I don't know what you're believing for today, but I do know that God is faithful.
Yes.
And he is true to his promises. And there is no situation or no giant that is too big, too hard, or too impossible for our God.
Yes.
Amen. And Father God, let faith arise in this place as we put our trust in you, Jesus.
My raging seas, you
Come on, with every believing heart, lift up your hands.
And I believe you're my healer. And I believe you are all I need. And I believe you're my portion. And I believe you're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all. Jesus, you're all I need. You're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all I forever in my life.
Jesus, you'll never let me go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You're an awesome God. You're an awesome God. You care for us, Lord Jesus. And you have a wonderful purpose for everyone here. We thank you, Lord Jesus, how you've been taking care of us, Lord, the past months, even this month as we enter April, the second quarter of this year. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that how you helped us before, you're going to help us again. Let's just dedicate this second quarter to the Lord. I know that there's a lot of things that probably a lot of you guys, it was rough for you for the last 3 months. It was rough. It was tough. It's not perfect. But we understand, you know, if you're still standing here, it means you are here by the grace of God. Amen. So, Father, with our hands upraised, we lift up our hands, Jesus. We lift up our hands and we dedicate, oh God, our lives. We dedicate, oh God, for the second quarter of this year. We dedicate, oh Jesus, our work, our school, our business, everything that we are involved with. Lord, we lift up everything to you, Lord Jesus, even our minds, that we may have your mind, the mind of Christ. Lord, Father, we lift up to you, Lord Jesus, our hearts. Guard our hearts, Lord Jesus, that, Father, you be the center of our hearts, center of all our decisions will all be because of you. Lord, Father, we dedicate to you, Lord God, all our dreams, our aspirations, our desires. We even, Lord, we dedicate to you our financial burdens. Lift it all up to you. All the challenges that each and everyone is going through, we lift up everything to you. We dedicate everything to you. Lord, I pray for wisdom. Wisdom, Lord, to happen, Lord God, in every single person, Lord God, that they will make wiser decisions. Decisions that honor you. And most especially, God, we pray for courage. Courage to keep on keeping on. Serving you, following you, and honoring you in all our decisions. That everything we do will honor you. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father, for what you're going to do in this next few months. Show yourself faithful, Lord God. And we praise you. We love you. We love you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. How many of you guys are believing for an awesome quarter? Yes? Amen. Amen. You know, well, one of the ways how we dedicate our year or our next few months or weeks is not only through our words, but through action, okay? And even through our tithes and offerings, it's one way you're showing God that you're going to trust Him. You are going to dedicate this next few weeks, this next few months to the Lord. I mean, who here would want the Lord to bless their finances? Well, again, it's quite simple. If you want the Lord to bless your finances, you got to put Him first in your finances. Amen? So, Lord Jesus, we lift up you, Lord God, our tithes and our offerings, and we start this month with our faith and trust in you. We know, Lord God, you're not interested in the amount of what's in our envelopes, but you're interested in what it represents. It represents our heart, our love, our hope, and trust in you. So we thank you, Father. We praise you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, welcome to April. That was pathetic. Is anybody glad it's April? Really? Okay, first week has gone by already. We'd like to announce something real important. This Saturday, ladies' prayer will be resumed, okay? 8 o'clock at our center. Every second Saturday of the month, we'd like to see the ladies of City Church come together for prayer. Any ladies in the house? That's pretty weak, yeah. All right. But then, of course, this Tuesday is a holiday, but we will still have our regular Tuesday prayer. We'll see you there at 8 o'clock. For those of you who don't usually have work, but it's a holiday for you, we want to see the house packed, okay? And so we'll see you on Tuesday for the regular prayer. And don't forget, ladies' prayer. Husbands, you need to make sure your wives go to prayer. You will live a more peaceful life if your wife is prayerful. Because she will complain, bring her complaints to the Lord instead of you. So do yourself a favor, all right? Okay. All right. Okay. Hey, we've got Color Me coming up as well. You got the slide on the screen that shows you the details. Tickets are available outside. This is our Color Me is our ladies' conference. We haven't had that in like 4 years already, so we're resuming that from before the lockdown actually happened. So we'd love to see you all there, all the ladies, power, girl power. And we want to make sure that it's really for the ladies of City Church, all right? Because usually we get around 2,000 ladies to pack this place, but we want to make sure City Church ladies will come first. And so the tickets are available. Usually they're gone in like 3 weeks, so don't think you can get it in the last minute, because City Church is never in the last minute kind of church. Good. Anything else you want to? Are you good? Yeah. By the way, it was Pastor Brian and Mika's anniversary yesterday. 15 years running strong. That was for you, but we had to force it out from them, sir. But say hello to somebody to your left and right. Would you do that? Okay, now turn around and look at the person behind you. Get a look at their face. Yeah, sometimes people steal stuff, right? So you want to make sure, okay, I got a face that I've marked. So make sure that you greet one another, get comfortable, get friendly. If you're here in City Church for the first time, you're wondering what this is all about. We are a church that helps other churches. We're not about building a City Church franchise all over the country. We want to make sure we go around, we help other churches. God has blessed this church so much. And that's why we want to share the blessing to others. We also have a morning service, and by the way, we had in the morning service at Seaside this morning was 228 children. Filipinos are fruitful and multiplying. My goodness, that's bigger than most churches in the country right there, just the children's ministry. So we need the volunteers to sign up. We have a children's ministry here as well. But what we've noticed in the past 2 months, this year, there's just been a surge of growth. Everything seems to be growing around us in church. And that's not because we're good. We don't have a follow-up program, evangelism program, visitation. Gosh, we've never done that. All we've done is lifted up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, if you lift my name up, I will draw all men, he said. That's the secret of what people ask us. How do you grow a church? Lift the name of Jesus up. Amen. And our desire is if you come here for the first time, just visit us once, you will come back. Warning, coming to City Church is habit forming. Amen. And by the time you leave today, you might have walked in dragging your feet, but we want to make sure you walk up out bigger, better, and stronger than before you came in. Amen. So we don't want you walking out looking sad, depressed, because everybody in the lobby of Waterfront's going, what happened in there? They went in happy, they came out sad. No, in this church, you go out and you've got joy in your heart. So look joyful, people. That's scary. Is that your best joyful look? And also, lastly, we want to welcome everybody that's watching us online. Wherever you are, let us know. Just drop a little message there, and we want to welcome everybody wherever you are in the world that's watching us, and let's come to the Word. You ready for the Word? Yeah. Father, we pray that every distraction in this room, even the person beside me, even my cell phone, would be silenced because your presence is here. And when you are here, we are here in your midst, there is joy. Thank you, Lord God, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. And to any person in this room that desperately needs a touch from you, the one that's feeling so down, so depressed, ready to give up, we specifically ask that you strengthen that one so that everyone will go out of this room full of you so we can share to the world your light and the message of hope in salvation in Christ Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Okay, that wasn't everybody who said amen, but I'll say amen. Hey, I'm in John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 1. Listen carefully to this. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God. For no one else can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born again when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered and said to him, are you the teacher of Israel, and you do not know these things? And so, Father, help us to know these things. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Which means, so be it. Let it be so. I'd like to entitle this message today, You Must Be Born Again. The story goes real simple. A teacher of the law, teacher of Israel, comes to Jesus at night asking a question. How is it that you do these miracles? No one can do miracles unless they're from God. And Jesus answers off tangent. It's like, you must be born again. He said, assuredly, in verse 3, Jesus answered him and said, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And so he says, how can that be? How can I enter into my mother's womb again? And Jesus answered in verse 5, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter. At first he said, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Now he says, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And then he says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And then he goes on to explain, and Nicodemus in verse 9 says, I don't get it. How can these things be? And Jesus in verse 10 basically says, you're a teacher? You don't understand these things? And so the question is, in verse 7, the statement is, do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. Okay? So when we say, you must be born again, I want to ask you this question. Do you even understand what it means to be born again? Are you born again yourself? Because Jesus said in verse 7, if you put it up on the screen again, you must be born again. He didn't say, I suggest you be born again. You can be born again. You should be born again. No, he said you must. In fact, the statement he made in verse 3, Jesus answered, most assuredly. In another version, surely, surely. In still another version, verily, verily. We don't use verily anymore. Are you hungry? Verily. That means I'm really, really hungry. And Jesus said, most assuredly, you must be born again. You can't go to heaven. You can't go to the Father. You can't see. You can't enter unless you are born again. Which brings us to the question, what does it really mean to be born again? And by the time you leave this room today, I pray there's a better understanding of it. Because most people think born again is simply this, a religion. And it's not. Here's what actually happened. His thought of born again was this, people. He said, can a man enter into his mother's womb again? That's pretty gross when you think about it. You must be born again. How can a man be born again? He's already big. He's already old. He did not understand what being born again is. And surprisingly, you might come to realize a lot of people who think they are Christians are not even born again. Let's get to that. What it is not. Number one, being born again, it is not a religion. It's not leaving one traditional church to enter into a church like this that is different from other churches. I pray that when you walked into this room, you might have been able to say to yourself, wow, this is different. Okay, so you didn't say that to yourself, but it's kind of different. We don't have the same liturgy or program. There's lights, there's audio, there's a band, there's people. It thumps on your chest. You know what I mean? And that doesn't mean that's born again. People think, born again de eka. They think that's a religion. It's not a religion. It's a condition of who you are. Understand? Which means to say you can be a person who's been attending church for the last 20 years, even serving, even singing, even teaching, and not be born again. And Jesus says to be born again, you are born of water, that's your flesh, and of spirit. Keeping up? Not really. Are you keeping up? You're awfully quiet. Secondly, it's not a religion. Attending a service or serving in a Christian church does not make you born again. You can sleep in the garage of your house and you will wake up still a person, not a car. In other words, attending here does not make you a born again person. The term born again Christian is actually redundant. If you are Christian, you are born of the Spirit. A Christian, to be a Christian is not understanding a belief system or a culture or obeying the Bible does not make you a Christian in itself. Attending this church does not make you born again. Even though the people that are behind this church, they are born again. Number three, reading your Bible and obeying it in certain laws does not make you born again. Nicodemus was of the Pharisees. Understanding Pharisees, they know the law. They memorize the five books of Moses. They know their scriptures so well, but he was not born again. He said, I know the scriptures, I teach it, but you must be from God. No one can do the miracles you do unless you're from God. He didn't even ask a question. Jesus answered. How many of you know Jews are kind of like that? Philosophical? He didn't say, how did you do that? He said, you must be from God. I mean, doing these things. And Jesus says, assuredly I say to you, you must be born again for you to see the kingdom of God. And if you've ever met a Jew, they're very philosophical, even almost argumentative, always right kind of people. They are the chosen people of God. And that's why if you ask a Jew, why is it that you Jews always answer a question with a question? In fact, whenever they ask Jesus a question, he would answer with a question. He says, you know, what are we to do with, are we supposed to pay tithes to Caesar? Look at this coin, Jesus said. And he says, he asks a question back. If you ask a Jew, why do you Jews always answer a question with a question? They'll usually answer, why shouldn't we? They're just like that, okay? Reading your Bible doesn't make you a Christian understanding it academically. You can have a degree in divinity. You can study master and actually know so much of the theology and so much of the doctrine. But knowing it doesn't make you born again. Fourthly, trying to live like Christ. I'm good. I obey the Ten Commandments. I don't do this anymore. I don't do that anymore. That does not make you born again. Why? Salvation is not by works. You can't be good enough to be born again. And so you're sitting there and you're wondering, hala, did I go born again? In fact, in Cebu, we call it, other people call us born against. And if a Christian left church and then came back to church after several years, we say in a born again, again. Don't make it a habit. So what is it to be born again? Title of this message, you must be born again. There's a big possibility there are people that even serve in a church, even preach in a church, are not born again. Seriously? Yes. Nicodemus was a teacher of the law, but he was not born again. Here we go. Ready for this? We have to start with you, the creation of man. How did God create man? He said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. And so he scoops in the ground and he fashions a man in his image and likeness, made out of the soil. That's why we are human beings. Human, humus, soil. We are people of the soil. That's why when your body dies, it goes to the ground again as dust. Amen. Look at your philosophical look. Gikremate man. Nalumos man. Gikaon sa iho. A shark ate it. No. Meaning to say it's disintegrated. We were made from the ground. And then there's a scripture in the beginning that says, and God breathed into man the breath of life. That word breathe, translated in the original text, was actually the same word as the word spirit. He into man the breath of life. He breathed into man his Holy Spirit. And the Bible says the man became a living soul. So a soul without the breath of God, without the Spirit of God, is dead. Keeping up? And so they were told that you can eat of every tree in the Garden of Eden, but you can't eat of that one which is in the middle of the garden. You're all familiar with that passage where Adam and Eve sinned, correct? Yeah. And you ever wondered why God even had to put a tree that was, you eat of everything, just not that. Don't eat the durian, you eat kaimito, manga, you eat everything. Just don't eat that one over there. And of course, you ask why did he put something that could test our disobedience? Because free will is not free will unless there's real choice. And so the choice was given for you to obey or disobey. And because God said, don't eat of it, guess what the woman became? Curious. Do you know women that are curious? But there's a new store. That's a new store. Let's try. Have you ever met a curious woman? Have you ever met an indifferent man? Why kalibutan? Doesn't even know. And that's why when it's time for dinner, it's like, dad, asa ta mangaon? Ambut lang, ikaw lay bahala. And so her curiosity hit her, because it's human nature to be like that. Don't eat of the fruit from the tree in the midst of the garden. So the woman was like, why not? In fact, when you say wet paint, do not touch. But top secret, do not open. You will open. Do not pick the flowers. Filipinos will pick. Do not step on the grass. That's cruel. Why have grass and not step on it? Do not step on the grass. Cebuano pa imo, why police? Hala. So the woman took of the fruit. She ate. She gave to her husband and he ate. And then God comes into the garden, questions him, investigates the whole thing, and they get casted out of God's presence. Here was the message before that. On the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. So you would think that as she took of the fruit and ate of it, it wasn't like that. But it was like that. 940 years later, Adam would die and Eve die. But God said, on the day you eat of it, you will die. So when did Adam really die? The moment he disobeyed God, the Spirit of God that gave life to his soul left him, departed from him. Amazing. You are a person with a body, and inside that body is a soul. Everybody here has a soul. Which incorporates your intellect. You have intellect. You have emotions. You have free will. You have a will, don't you? Come on. There's a saying, where there's a will, there's a way. Binisaya pa kung naay ligid, naay dalan. Kind of off, but you know what I mean. You have a will. You have a way to choose things. A five-year-old will say, I don't like that. I want this. That's exercising of their will. Everybody has a soul that's inside your body. Amen? And within that soul also houses the spirit of a person, the Spirit of God. Can you imagine this great, big, huge, immense Spirit of a God can actually be inside a human being? Amazing how large the soul of man can be. In fact, you can fill this soul with all the wealth in the world and you still lack in life. You can fill it with all the love in the world. You will still lack because your soul was designed to fit God on the inside. And you can fill all the whole world and lose your soul. And you ever wondered why really rich people that are famous as well and powerful, you ever wonder why they commit suicide? They reach a pinnacle of emptiness in everything they had. And that's what happened with King Solomon. He had 700 wives and 300 women on the side. That's a lot of women. All the married men in this room know one is more than enough. Sobra, sobra na. Can you imagine 700 women? Where were the counselors of Solomon? Where are the advisors that, oh, andam ta, maminyot na sad si sir. And of course, all the workers and all the servants, again? I mean, how many is that already? He had so many women, he probably had to have a QR code. Which one are you? They had to register. But you know what? He wrote in Ecclesiastes, even he had all these things. He said, life is vanity under the sun. My life is empty. That's why people that can get so famous and have all the money in the world and all the fame in the world, they realize how empty their lives is because the soul of man is only fulfilled by the Spirit of God in its fullness. And then you have the Spirit. That's the Spirit is not the same as the soul. And when Adam and Eve sinned, the Spirit of God that was breathed into man departed because sin and God do not mix together. Keeping up? So now with that emptiness, listen carefully, there's no such thing as a spiritual vacuum. It's either dark or light. Where there's no light, it's dark. Where there's darkness, there is no light. There's no such thing as none of both. When God's Spirit left mankind, there was an emptiness on the inside, and the spirit of that man, the Adamic spirit that tended to sin, now ruled over him, and he died. Yeah, his body was still alive, but to be disconnected from the source of life is death itself. So if you take a flower and pluck it off its tree, this morning we used gumamela, but for you, rose na lang, rose, because I think you identify with a rose better. Ayo. You take a rose, you pluck it out, you snip it off, you're holding a rose. Question, is it alive or is it dead? It's a real rose, not plastic. It's real. Is it alive or is it dead? And most people will say it's alive. But we will tell you this, the moment you cut it from the source of life, it had died. The process of death had begun. Give it a few hours, it'll start to wilt. In 3 days, it looks a lot more ugly now. And later on, you'll see, oh, it's dead already. Why? When you cut off the rose from its bush, the rose doesn't stay alive and the bush dies. Correct? Let me illustrate. Giputol ang rose, namatay ang bush, the rose is still alive. No, the source is where the life comes from. You separate from the source, you're dead. The day that he sinned, he separated from God. Death had begun. The process of wilting has now begun. And that's why you and I, our bodies die. Hello? In fact, when you and I were born, we were all born cute. Unbelievably, the person beside you once upon a time was cute. But as time went on, the body begins to wrinkle, dimple, crinkle, creak. You ever heard a man stand up and... because he's old. Why? Death has begun. From dust we were made, and to dust we shall return. But there was a difference. The soul of man, disconnected from God, would be so empty without God that God would have to intervene into man's life. Spirit, soul, and body, you've got to listen to this. All mankind has sinned. Amen? Amen. The cutest person in this room, you will age too one day. You will never see an 85-year-old Lola. Look, hot palagi, cute palagi siya. You'll never see. They wrinkle. Actually, you know, they're old. And it's there's a peak season of life. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. After Adam and Eve had sinned, separated from God, they could not stay in God's presence, kicked out of the garden. They had children, and all their children carried the same spirit of their father, which is a sinful spirit. That's why no matter how cute a baby is, no matter how you teach it well, it will sin. We never taught our children to sin. We taught our children how to obey, how to be good people. But they still sinned, just like you. For the Bible says all have sinned. Sheila bakes chocolate cakes. Don't give us a chocolate cake, okay? Please. She bakes the best chocolate cakes. She does. Don't order, because her husband helps her sift the chocolate. And because when I have to sift it, and she'll say, oh, and I order chocolate. I'm like that. So I'm sifting it with this screen, and it gets very powdery everywhere. So she tells me, get an old sheet and put it on you. Hey, can you imagine? I'm sitting on a stool for somebody's chocolate. And when she makes it, it really is delicious. Amen. All right. So there's always a little bit extra. We have two little at the time. Our boys were little. They're like two little puppies waiting for their mommy to finish baking. Give us some. And she leaves a little bit for them. And even the mixer thing, they have one each. And they lick all the chocolate icing. And Sheila says, okay, that's for you. But this cake, don't touch it, because somebody's going to pick it up for their birthday. Okay, so don't touch the cake. You got that? Yes, mommy. So we go out, we come back. The cake looks intact, but we see on their faces chocolate stains. The kid's 7 years old and four, and Sheila gets frantic. She gets emotional. Of course, her cake. Did you eat the cake? Yeah. And the boys, no, no. You can tell when a little boy's lying, his lower lip goes out. No, no, I didn't do it. But then Sheila said, how come you have chocolate all over your lips? And then he says, he did it first. The other one, no, you did. No, you did. You both did. But the amazing thing was, the cake was intact. How did they eat the cake when it looks... You know what they did? At the very bottom of the cake, they pushed the icing up, scooped with their fingers all around to eat the cake, and then put the icing back on. We never taught them how to do that. The nature of man is to sin. I did that as a little six-year-old boy. I was always curious how things work. So we had this clock in the house. It was an old clock. And every hour it would chime. And I was wonder how it does that. So I got a screwdriver. I opened it up and I saw the insides of a clock. It was amazing. Things are turning. And then there was some big round thing in the middle. I thought, what was this? So I unscrewed that. Did you ever unscrew a real old clock? There's what is inside called a clock spring. And it's about 2 meters long. It's coiled like that. But six-year-old boys don't know that it's like that. So I open it up, and all of a sudden, boing, the whole thing flaps out. And I freak out. You know what I did? I was so scared, I tried to put it back. It was impossible. I covered it again. I closed everything up. And I took that long clock spring, and I went to the fence and threw it on the other side. Nobody ever taught me to do that. It was my nature to sin. Okay? So, because the spirit of God had left him, that Adamic, carnal, worldly spirit was working in conjunction with the demonic. Sin came in. All have sinned. And that's why no matter what you do, I'll obey God. That does not make you born again. To have the Spirit of God come back into you will take a miracle from God. Romans 5:19, for as by one man's disobedience, Adam, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, Jesus, many will be made righteous. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Listen carefully. To be born again, to enter the kingdom of God, to even see the kingdom of God, number one, you and I need a savior. You can't save yourself. What is religion? It's basically man's attempt at saving himself. You and I need a savior. Because you can follow the Bible all you want, but the Spirit of God will not come back into you until you make certain surrendering in faith. We need a savior. Number two, it takes a miracle to be born again. You can't be born again all by yourself. You can't be born again coming to church. You cannot, because to be born again is to have the Spirit of God back into your life again. And we'll show you how that is done. Here's an illustration. If we took a monkey from the jungles, took a baby monkey, took care of the monkey, groomed it, not expose it to other monkeys, expose it only to people, and then we'd feed it, give it a spoon and fork, and teach it how to use a spoon and fork. Then we'd clothe the monkey, and then we'd disciple the monkey. We'd put it in a little cell group so that we'll learn how to be human in all its things. They hear music and the monkey dances. People come and say, oh, look at that monkey, Muragtao. Okay. Guess what? What will it take? How much training, how much teaching, how much discipleship, how much exposure to the culture of human beings will convert a monkey into a human being? Impossible. It's not possible for a human to become a monkey. It will still be a monkey that might behave like a human being. In fact, have you met human beings that behave like monkeys? Okay, that's the other way around. But if you train a monkey, no matter how cultured the monkey looks, it sits down, it knows how to cross its legs. When it's thinking, it knows how to do this. When it sees a camera, it also knows how to do this. Then you say, oh, Muragtao, but it's like a human, but it's still a monkey. A cultured, educated, sophisticated monkey, but a monkey nonetheless. What would it take for a monkey to become human? A miracle. Can't do it by itself. You can train it all you want. Ni graduate pa ang monkey ug eskwela. It's still a monkey, okay? Because it's impossible. How do you become born again? Which brings us to the third point. We need to become a new creation. You cannot educate, disciple, train, teach, expose, no matter what you do. A monkey is still a monkey, and a human being cannot become a child of God just by coming to church. You can put a monkey in a human's house, it's still a human. You can attend this church, you are still an old human being who has the sinful nature of God. The sinful nature of God. Oh, excuse me, the sinful nature of man, of Adam. We need the righteous nature of God. And so, another animal we need to bring. Are you okay with animals today? Yeah. If we got a pig and a sheep and exchange their nature, you take the nature of a pig and put it in the sheep. You take the nature of the sheep and you put it into the pig. In our case, if you would take the spirit of a pig, pigs don't have spirits, by the way. If you took a spirit of a pig, by illustration, and placed it in a monkey, in a sheep, you know what you would have? You would have a sheep that will love the mud. You will have a sheep that behaves like a pig, looks like a sheep, but is a pig on the inside. He'll see mud and he'll go to the mud and enjoy it. And we would walk by, look, who God was a sheep? Oh, sheep don't like mud. How come this sheep does? Because its nature is of the pig. Now we go to the pig and we look at the pig and we realize, oh my goodness, what's wrong with this pig? It's so clean. It's so cultured. It sees the other pigs in the mud and goes, ew, because it's more cultured now. When it oinks sophisticatedly. Oink, oink. What has happened? The nature of the sheep was placed into the pig, and the nature of the pig was placed into the sheep. God created humans to have his nature, but man rejected that nature and took the world's nature and put it inside himself. I don't believe what God is saying. I believe what the serpent is telling me. And so I will disobey God and I will eat of this fruit. And that's why that nature came into man and it was no longer the Spirit of God. So now you have a human being that's sinning when it wasn't made to sin. Are you getting the point? That when a human sins, it's not his nature to actually be like that. A human being was made to glorify God. And so what do humans do? They make religious laws. Thou shalt not do this. Thou shalt not do that. They make religion. And religion is man's way of saying, I need to get back to God. There's something missing in my life. Every religion will try to point you to God. It's just that they don't know the God that you're being pointed to. And that's where Jesus comes into the picture. And so when human realizes, I need God in my life, there was something lacking in him. And that's why you can be rich, successful, beautiful, young looking till you're 70, but your life will still lack because you are designed to house God on the inside. Are you keeping up with me? Okay. And that's why we need, the only way is we need to have a new spirit again. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man, anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. David said, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Because he knew his heart was away from God, trying to do godly things with the wrong spirit. Listen carefully to this. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And that's what has to happen to us. His spirit has to come into us, not trying to obey the words of God. I want to tell you, the most difficult, impossible thing to do is follow Jesus Christ with your old nature. It just doesn't work. You can follow every letter of the law. Nicodemus was memorizing the letters, trying to obey. You can obey every letter of the law. All you will be is an obedient person, but still with the old nature. The only way is a miracle has to happen in your life. wherein his nature comes into you. That means you can be serving in church. That means you know the songs. You can read your Bible, attend a cell group. You can actually be a good volunteer. You can even be a preacher. You can even sing songs and compose songs for Christ and later on say, I don't believe in God anymore. You never did. You see, when you have the nature of Christ, you will know, because now on the inside, you don't come to church because you have to. You don't come to church because you're scared if you don't come to church, God will get angry. You come to church now with a new nature because I want to. I want to come to church. I want to read my Bible. I want, if you're a lady, I want to attend a ladies' prayer meeting. I want to join Color Me. I don't have to be forced to. There's no culture, no peer pressure, no law that says you must not do this, you must do that. In fact, that's why you're not saved by works. You can do all the works and still not be born again or a Christian. Hardest thing to do is walking as a Christian when you're not. Amen? It's hard for a monkey to behave like a human when it's not his nature. So this is what happened to me. I gave my life to Jesus, and this is how it works. Number one, you have to recognize you're a sinner. All have fallen short. All have sinned. There's none righteous. I had to recognize I am a sinner. Because you might be a good person, but you're still a sinner. You might not smoke anymore, but you're still a sinner. See, once upon a time, I did smoke. Not habitually, socially. When people around me were smoking, they gave me, okay, I'll smoke with you. But I wasn't a type who would look for it. Whenever we'd get around, we'd talk, we'd do whatever, we'd smoke. And so I'd smoke with them. But then I gave my life to Jesus one day. I walked into a seminar that I didn't know was a seminar for Christ. Her mother, Sheila's mother, attended this charismatic seminar and said, you guys need to join. You need to join. I said, I don't want to join. I don't believe in God. I don't do God things. Because when I met Sheila, I was surprised. She'd ride in the car, and every now and then she'd do. I said, would you do that? It's a church. I said, really? Why do you have to do that? Because I just do. And so she taught me religious things, and I didn't believe in it. And then my mother-in-law. How many of you know mother-in-laws can be influential in your life? Okay, you had a weak mother-in-law. I had a strong mother-in-law. You guys need to attend this seminar. I didn't want to attend the seminar. She said, you just drop me off. Okay, so we dropped her off. She said, Sheila, sakalan kadiyo, take a look. And so Sheila went up, and I waited in the car. We didn't have cell phones at that time. So I decided to walk in. I looked for the room where they were. I didn't know where the room was. I pushed open a door, and the door happened to be on the side of the platform. And I walked straight in, and I'm in. And the guy speaking said, come in, come in, come in. Ushers, get him, get him. I was backing off. No, 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 you come. You know what? Next thing you know, I'm seated on the front row. And, of course, Sheila and her mother was at the back. I'm reluctantly, awkwardly sitting in the front row to listen to a man. And he began to preach. And everything he preached about was for me. It's like, I think I got set up by my mother-in-law. I just think she told him everything. Because when you're not a Christian, you're suspicious of everything. And I was, maybe they want our money. I was suspicious. And so he began to talk. And he said, maybe you think you're really good. And I did. Maybe you think you don't need God. And I did think like that. Maybe you drove here with a really nice car. And I did drive with a really nice car. And he named the brand. I said, that's the brand. I'm thinking, have you ever sat in a message and it was exactly for you? Every comment was about me. Every joke was about me. Na heart good ko. It's like, why are they all laughing? That's my life. Maybe you think you're so bright and that you don't need God. Yeah, that's me. And so he said, everybody bow your heads in prayer. Because I was convicted. It bothered me. He said, you think you have everything. But you know, when you shut the light switch at night, you stare at a dark ceiling, you know you're empty because you're just living all by yourself. You have tried to make yourself your own God. And I did. And he said, close your eyes, everybody. No, not me. I'm on the front row. He's looking this way. Everybody, bow your heads. Asaka bow. I didn't. And he's talking this way and he says, bow your head. Come on, you can bow your head. You can. He can see through his ears. Because I'm here and he's talking there. You need to bow your head. Come on, you can bow your head. It's the beginning of humility. You won't bow your head, it just shows you're proud. Oh, I bowed my head. He said, that's good. So I went, bow your head again. Every eye closed. I didn't want to close my eyes. He said, if you don't close your eyes, you'll be distracted by looking at the shoes of the person beside you. And I was. I was actually saying, "Hugawag spatos ni tohan." He said, close your eyes. And I did. And he looked on the other side. How many of you here, this message was just for you, and it was for me. And if that's you, God is talking to you. And in my mind, I'm going, And he began to challenge me. Number one, you have to recognize you're a sinner. Number two, you have to repent of your sins. And that's what he asked us to do. You need to repent. And I thought, repent? I like sinning. He says, no, repent is not an emotion. It's not sorrow. It's not guilt. It's turning a decision to turn your life around. He says, you can fill your life with everything in this world. Your life will feel empty. In fact, you feel that emptiness right now. And I did. And so I did repent. Repent is to say, I want to turn my life around. Some of you are sitting in this room and you're actually saying, you know, I'm pretty sick and tired of life. I seem to have everything, but my life's still empty. And God is asking you to repent. A repentance is to you turn and go in the direction of Christ, away from sin and towards Christ. You can't play both. Thirdly, you've got to receive Jesus into your life. You've got to invite him in. Repent, acknowledge you're a sinner, repent of your sin, and ask him to come into your life. And he said, you know you need God. And I realized I did. And then he challenged me to receive God. Would you raise your hand if this message, God is talking to you? I said, sobrang napod ning tawhana. Close eyes, bow heads, close eyes. He says, you can raise your hands. Come on, you can. And I decided I can. He's looking over here, and I'm over there, and I did this. And he said, you can raise it higher. And I did. He said, that's good. You can still go higher. What's up with this guy? And he says, for all those who raise their hands, can you all please step forward? I want to pray for you. So that's too much. I can't do it. I'm not going to do that. And he says, Jesus left the throne in heaven to come down on the cross for you. And you can't take a few steps. That punched me in the gut so hard. He said, let's all stand up. And those of you who lifted up your hands, come forward. I don't know what hit me. I know who hit me. I stood up with everybody else. Because if everybody else stands up and you don't, kiwao man, right? So I stood up. He says, come on, take a few steps forward. Diko, adoko di. And you know what he said? This hit me so hard, I still use it. If you're arguing in your own mind if you should go or not, end the argument, lift those feet, and take some steps forward. I challenge you, if you're a real man, step forward. You know what I did? Na challenge you go, because I'm the kind of person, you challenge me, hala. And I stood up and I went forward, and something happened to me when I stepped forward in faith like that. I just broke together with all the other people. I began to weep and cry, tears flowing out of my eyes. It was just popping out like that. And I could hear people crying. And you know when you're about to cry and people cry, you know what happens? You'll cry. And when they hear you crying, they'll cry more. And when you hear them cry more, you'll cry more. Next thing you know, everyone's crying. And there was someone crying that sounded so familiar. And I looked, it was Sheila. She was beside me. And guess what would happen? What happened? When I looked, she had tears like me. She had sutanghon coming down, bihon coming down. And we began to speak in other tongues. I said, I don't know what's going on, but something's really happening. I couldn't understand myself. And guess what began to happen? She cried more. And I saw her crying. I cried more. And she saw me cry. What a mess! And I thought to myself, why am I here? What got me into this? But someone came on the inside, and my life totally changed. It was the most beautiful experience ever. I don't want to say feeling, because he's not a feeling. And then afterwards, we all left the room, and I stepped into the world. And it seemed so noisy. It seemed so glary. I said, what's happening? I drove them home, and then I drove home by myself. And I thought, what happened? I don't know what happened. I spoke in other tongues. It was crazy. Nobody, I didn't know. I did not know a wink about the Bible. But God came into my life. I went home and did my usual after-dinner smoke. And it... something's wrong. Got another, my mother's cigarette. Went to Burt's store, bought fresh cigarettes. I still wanted to, but someone on the inside did not want to anymore. You see, when Christ comes on the inside of you, if you were a monkey before, ungui things don't entertain you anymore. And I started to look for God. I started to talk to God. I even said, God, if you're real, because I wasn't sure, but I was sure, but I wasn't sure. I said, God, what happened? As I tried to ask, what happened? You know what came out? I began to speak in tongues. I said, oh my goodness, am I going to be like this forever? But that's where the change began. You know what it was? Not works, not anything else, but putting your faith in his life. And today, you can do that. You might have been coming to church a lot, but the Bible says, put off the old man and put on the new man. And that's what all of us have to do. You might be coming to church a lot, but if you've never truly acknowledged you're a sinner, surrendered your life to him, invited him to come into your life, perhaps you're a good human being, doing Christian things with Christians, but you're not a Christian. You're not born of the Spirit until his Spirit replaces what you have on the inside. So do I still sin? Yeah. Do you ever sin? There are times. There are things he took away instantly. There are things it was a struggle. But his nature was in me now. You get my point? In other words, for example, a thief steals. And when a thief steals, he's doing something consistent with his nature. He lies down and there's a smile on his face. He tells his friends about it. He's proud about it. But when a Christian steals, he's not a thief. He's a child of God doing something that is contrary to the nature of Christ on the inside. And if you have truly received the Spirit of God, sin will always bother you now. Every time you sin, it will bother you because you're doing something of your old creature. That's not you anymore. It's not a religion. It's not a church. It's not practices. It's who you are on the inside of you. That's how you become born again in Jesus' name. Amen. And so with that, now it's your turn to bow your heads. And there's somebody in this room who's like me. Bow your heads. It's your first step of humility. Close your eyes. Or else you'll look at your sister's feet and think, maybe this message was for you today. Maybe you've been coming to church a lot, but church doesn't have its punch anymore. You were doing church stuff with the old you. You need to be born again. in Jesus' words, you must be born again. Not an option. It's imperative. It's a prerequisite to heaven. As you bow your heads in prayer and you close your eyes, look into your life. Does your life feel empty? Despite knowing, saying you know Christ, doing Christian things, is there something on the inside of you that when you default and close all the wall, all the sites you've looked into, your wallpaper is still, I feel empty with my life. You can be a preacher and feel empty because you're not born in the Spirit. You can be teachers like Nicodemus. You can know the law. You can memorize it. You can quote it. You can teach it. But until the Spirit of God has been invited into your life, you're an Adam trying to do Christian things. You'll just be a monkey playing around with your Christianity. If your life senses that emptiness, take that challenge and humble yourself. If that's you today and you want to make sure, I am born of the Spirit. We're not inviting you to this church or to a religion. We're inviting you to totally surrender your life in Christ. If that's you today, and God is speaking to you, would you lift your hands up? Hands lifting, going up. Don't lift your hands up because others are lifting it. Lift it up because you really know I need the presence and the Spirit of God in my life. Praise God. Life group leaders, I need you to come forward as well. Everybody stand to your feet. And everyone who raised their hands, I want to challenge you to come forward and join Sheila and Jello and Pastor JP and Pastor Grace. Come forward. Come forward today. And everybody, give them a big hand for the amazing decision in humility in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, you come forward today. Your life will never be the same again. And being a Christian is not something you do. It now becomes someone you are because Jesus is on the inside. Lay your hands on this altar now to receive the Holy Spirit right now. Praise God. Keep coming. If you're standing at your seat and you're saying, I can do this where I am, take that pride away. Come forward today. You all come forward if you have to. Now, take a few steps forward. If there's space in front of you, take a few steps forward so others can, you make room for others as well. Jesus, praise God. Thank you, Lord. Now listen up. Listen up just for a moment. Just for a moment. Everybody look up. Everybody look up for a minute. Look at me. Look at me. Everybody look at me. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. You can answer with your mouth, but it needs to be meant through your heart. Don't just say it. Don't just think it. Speak it out of your heart. Mean it when I lead you in this prayer. And after that, we will thank God together. Amen. Pray with me this prayer. Lord Jesus. Come on, everybody in this room, help them out. Lord Jesus, I come before you today. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I even enjoy sin. I habitually commit sin. Come on, say it out of your mouth. I have sinned, but today I repent. I want to turn my life around. I want my old self to be put away, and I invite you into my heart. Thank you, Jesus. You died on the cross and gave your Spirit up for every one of us to receive. Thank you for paying for our sins. Blot out all my transgressions, all my sin. Wash me from my past. And I invite you into my heart today. Oh God, come into my heart. Oh, come on, say it like you mean it. Come into my heart, oh God. Deposit your Holy Spirit in me. Write my name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. And save me, Lord God. Thank you. I receive you today by faith that you love me, you care for me, and as I draw near to you, you will draw near to me. You said you will not cast out any man that comes to you. I come to you today. Come in my heart. In Jesus' name, I declare I am a child of God. And my past is past. The old has gone. A new creation has come. In Jesus' name, amen. Make this song your prayer. Every person that has sincerely, in faith, surrendered their lives to you, fill them with your life and change the old nature that they were. That old creation goes away and the new creation has come. Let them walk out of this place to put off the old man and to put on the new man. In Jesus' name. Let the miracle of rebirth, born all over again, a new chance to live, come upon this person to my left and right, to every person that has prayed that prayer, in Jesus' name. Can you declare to me, to him right now, would you declare to God, I am a new creation. The old has passed, the new has come. I am a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Would you praise God? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, a miracle just happened in your life. Now, of course, all of you want a new body as well. Lord, why do I still have the same old face? No, what's important is the person on the inside is a new person. That means you don't walk out of this place and go back to the mud, because you're not a pig anymore. You're sheep. You're a child of God. That means old things, old habits begin to break one by one. You will go out of this place. You go out of this place new. Say new. New. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Hey, you can return to your seats. And there's a song we're going to close with in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Before we let Pastor Joe go, today is your spiritual birthday, but it's his birthday this coming Tuesday. We want to bless this man. How many of you are blessed by Pastor Joe? Come on, lift up your hands. Decades and decades of ministry, God has been gracious. Amen. Can you extend your hand toward Pastor Joe? Even the worship team, come on, get around him right here. Join us here, Dita Sheila, Pastor JP. Shalom. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Father, we are grateful for this man's life. We thank you for the many, many years of strength and wisdom and favor that he has walked with. So, Lord, together as a church, every good blessing that you've given to us, we pour onto him. And we thank you because the next years of his life will be even more fruitful. There will be expansion, Lord, more wisdom, more favor. That, Lord, his decisions, Lord, will be God-led decisions, not just a decision of the flesh. And, Lord, we speak a blessing over his marriage, over his family. I thank you for unity in his household, order in the home. And I thank you for good health, amazing days, Lord God, ahead, a new vision, a fresh perspective. And I thank you that the Spirit of God is so alive in him. Look at the harvest in this room. Decades of seeds on the ground. So, Lord, today we call the seeds to come forth, to bear fruit. And, Lord, fruit that will last. Lord, thank you. What a beautiful life, Lord, that we're watching before us. And Lord, through him, let many, many more leaders begin to arise. Leaders with a call, leaders with direction. And as he leads by example, may it always be said that Jesus was the center of his heart and his life. Thank you, Lord God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Everybody says, amen, amen. Even before this service is over, go ahead and greet Pastor Joe and all of you that went forward, that came forward today. We want to say happy birthday to you as well. You got to remember this day because we declare no turning back in Jesus' name. Come on, all across the room, lift up your hands to heaven. Father, as we come to you in worship, we want to put you first. We want to put you central to what we do. This church is not about any person. It's not about what we do and how we do it. It's about the man, God, Christ Jesus. So, Lord, this is our worship unto you. We bless you in Jesus' name.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me.
Savior, then
on the Holy Spirit. Almighty River, come and fill me again. Come and fill me
Thank you for coming today, church. Know that without God, we are nothing. As you go out, there's a booth outside for Color Me. Tickets are already available. See you next week. God bless you.